let's take a closer look at tachycardia for the pediatric patient. An infant's or child's heart rate that is greater than normal for their age, activity level, and clinical condition is considered tachycardia. Now, many things can cause tachycardia. Semi-benign things like a fever or stress, or more serious causes like shock and medications, metabolic dysfunction, hypoxemia, and damage to the heart muscle can all cause pediatric tachycardia. Perfusion problems may develop when the heart beats too fast and the ventricles are not able to fill properly with blood. This can cause a decrease in cardiac output and poor perfusion, and that leads to hemodynamic instability. The faster the heart rate, the more likely the tachycardia is the cause of the patient's symptoms. A thorough primary and secondary survey will help us properly assess the patient's underlying condition. Now, important steps in caring for an infant or child with tachycardia are to treat the underlying causes first. Our first goal is to make sure we first maintain a patent airway and provide adequate oxygenation. The goal is to maintain an oxygen saturation of at least 94%. Next, we should get a cardiac monitor attached to correctly evaluate what that underlying rhythm is. And if we can, we're going to obtain a 12-lead ECG, but let's be sure not to delay treatment in order to get that 12-lead. There are some helpful signs that can help us identify the type of tachycardia seen on the ECG. First, we want to determine whether the QRS is wide or narrow. A normal or narrow QRS for a pediatric patient is 0.09 seconds or less. Narrow complex tachycardias typically originate above the ventricles. In contrast, wide complex tachycardias typically originate in the ventricles and have a higher risk of deteriorating into full cardiac arrest. Now, before I distinguish the different rates for SVT versus sinus tach, I really want to simply state that the major difference between the two is that a sinus tach, though difficult to see on an ECG, will have a P wave. Supraventricular tachycardia does not, in my experience, and therefore SVT is more unstable and the rate with sinus tach can sometimes be changed with activity. Now, all of that being said, if the patient has a normal QRS, we still need to determine whether the patient has sinus tachycardia or supraventricular tachycardia. Sinus tach for an infant is usually a heart rate less than 220 beats per minute, and in a child, the heart rate is usually less than 180 beats per minute. The patient's history is usually consistent with the cause of the tachycardia. P waves are present and normal, and the QRS is normal. Heart rate varies with the level of activity. Typically, the sinus tachycardia does not require treatment. Rather, it is important to search for and treat the cause. Now, with SVT, for an infant, typically they are going to have a heart rate greater than 220 beats per minute. And in a child, the heart rate is usually greater than 180 beats per minute. The QRS is normal, but the P waves are usually absent. The patient history usually reveals an abrupt change in the heart rate or may be ambiguous as to what caused the change. The heart rate does not vary with the level of activity. And for treatment of a patient with a regular, narrow, complex, stable tachycardia, it would be appropriate to attempt vagal maneuvers first. For a child, have them attempt to blow through a narrow straw. And for an infant, you could place a bag with ice water over the upper half of the infant's face, making sure not to obstruct the airway. If these vagal maneuvers do not work, we may want to consider adenosine, 0.1 milligram per kilogram rapid IV push, and it should also be followed with a 20 cc bolus of normal saline in order to expedite the delivery of the medication. If the patient does not convert and remains stable, a second dose of adenosine may be given at 0.2 milligrams per kilogram rapid IV push. Again, we're going to want to chase that treatment with 20 cc's of normal saline. For a stable patient with an ECG rhythm that shows an irregular, narrow, complex QRS tachycardia, though quite unusual, it may likely be atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, or multifocal atrial tachycardia. This may require expert consultation for proper treatment. For a stable patient that has regular or irregular wide complex QRS tachycardia, it would be wise to seek expert consultation as well. Often, antiarrhythmics are used to treat this, such as procainamide or amiodarone. However, the management and treatment of wide complex stable tachycardias requires advanced knowledge of ECG rhythm interpretation and antiarrhythmic therapy. If a child is experiencing SVT or wide complex tachycardia and remains stable and does not respond to the medication therapy, we should consult a pediatric cardiologist before we proceed with synchronized cardioversion. For a child with unstable tachycardia, such as a child with hypotension, synchronized cardioversion would be the appropriate first choice. Sedation, if needed or time allows, would be appropriate, but we don't want to delay cardioversion that is required to stabilize the patient. We're going to start with an energy dose of 0.5 to 1 joule per kilogram. If the initial dose is ineffective, increase that electrical dose to 2 joules per kilogram. Make sure to record and monitor the ECG before, during, and after each cardioversion attempt. And it's important to ensure that the defibrillator is set to cardioversion, not defibrillation. After cardioversion has been successful, we're going to want to obtain a 12-lead ECG and be sure to pass this patient on to the appropriate next stage of treatment.